If you really have been thinking during this break, you'll surely have some sharp questions in mind. First of all, why is Mahler's Ninth Symphony his last will and testament? What about the Tenth, that highly significant, unfinished document? And then, why play the Mahler Ninth to end a lecture on the 20th century crisis? Isn't this backtracking? Having moved with Berg and Schoenberg into the mid-century, why now retrogress to that fateful year of 1908? Because, like the Ives unanswered question, which was written in the same year, this ninth Mahler is also a great question, but it's more. It contains a deeply revealing answer. I had planned to prepare you for this music with my customary analysis at the piano, going in depth into the dualisms that tore Mahler apart, composer, conductor, Christian, Jew, sophisticate, naive, provincial, cosmopolitan, and all the rest, all of which resulted in the musical schizodynamics of his textures and his ambivalent tonal attitudes. I had also hoped, by a detailed analysis of his treatment of appoggiaturas, for example, to reach the essence of the tonal crisis through examining his non-resolution of tensions, his reluctant attempts to let go of tonality, all of which does shed further light on the inevitable split that was to occur between Schoenberg and Stravinsky. And so I picked up the score again after some years away from it, filled with the sense of Mahler's torture at knowing he was the end of the line, the last point in the great symphonic arc that began with Haydn and Mozart, finished with him. And I was again aware that it was his destiny to sum up the whole story of Austro-Germanic music, to recapitulate it and tie it up, not in a pretty bow by any means, but in a fearful knot made out of his own nerves and sinews. But while restudying this work, especially the final movement, I found more answers than I'd expected, as we always do when we return to the study of a great work. And the most stunning, the most important one, because it illuminates our whole century from then to now, is this, that ours is the century of death and Mahler is its musical prophet. I want to talk to you about that answer, without the piano, without visual aids, and on a somewhat different level of discourse from the one we've been following, because this Ninth Symphony offers us a great semantic expansion, an infinitely broader interpretation of what we've been calling the 20th century crisis. Why is our century so uniquely death-ridden? Couldn't we say this of other centuries as well? What of the 19th century, so poetically preoccupied with death, whether as late as Wagner's Liebestod or as early as Keats' Nightingale? I have been half in love with easeful death, called him soft names in many a mused rhyme. Yes, true, poetically, symbolically true. And haven't all centuries, all human histories, been a long record of the struggle to survive, to deal with the problem of mortality? Again, yes. But never before has mankind been confronted by the problem of surviving global death, total death, the extinction of the whole race. And Mahler was not alone in his vision. There have been other great prophets of our struggle. Freud, Einstein, and Marx have also prophesied, as have Spengler and Wittgenstein, even Malthus and Rachel Carson. All latter-day Isaiahs and St. John's, all preaching the same sermon in different terms, mend your ways, the apocalypse is at hand. Rilke said it too, du musst dein Leben ändern. The 20th century has been a badly written drama from the very beginning, the opposite of a Greek drama. Act One. Greed and hypocrisy leading to a genocidal world war. and post-war injustice and hysteria, a boom, a crash, totalitarianism. Act two, greed and hypocrisy leading to a genocidal world war, post-war injustice and hysteria, boom, crash, totalitarianism. Act three, greed and hysteria. I don't dare continue. And what have been the antidotes? Logical positivism, existentialism, galloping technology, the flight into outer space, the doubting of reality, and overall a well-bred paranoia, most recently on display in the high places of Washington, D.C. And our personal antidotes, making it, dope, subcultures and countercultures, turning on, turning off, marking time and making money, and a rash of new religious movements from Guruism to Billy Grahamism, and a rash of new art movements from concrete poetry to the silences of John Cage. A thaw here, a purge there, and all under the same aegis, the angel of planetary death. What do you do if you know all this back in 1908, if you're a hypersensitive like Mahler, and instinctively know what's coming? You prophesy, and others pick up your trail. In one way or another, Mahler lies at the essential core of all the significant music written after him, whether tonal or non-tonal. Even such diverse composers as Varese and Dalla Piccola are inconceivable without Mahler. Shostakovich and Britten are at their greatest when they are most like Mahler. And so both Schoenberg and Stravinsky, Mahler's two continuing prophets, utterly different as they are, spent their lives both struggling in their opposite ways to keep musical progress alive, to avert the evil day. In fact, all the truly great works of our century have been born of despair or of protest or of a refuge from both. But anguish informs them all. Think of Sartre's Nausée, Camus' Stranger, Gide's Counterfeiters. The Sun Also Rises, The Magic Mountain and Dr. Faustus, The Last of the Just, even Lolita, and Picasso's Guernica, and Tirico, Dali, and Eliot's Cocktail Party, Murder in the Cathedral, the Four Quartets, and Auden's Age of Anxiety, and that supreme work of his, For the Time Being, and Pasternak, and Neruda, and Sylvia Plath, and on the screen, La Dolce Vita, and on the stage, Waiting for Godot, and Wozzeck, Lulu, Moses and Aaron, and Brecht's Mother Courage. And yes, also Eleanor Rigby, and A Day in the Life, and She's Leaving Home. These two are great works, born of despair, touched with death. And Mahler foresaw it all. That's why he so desperately resisted entering this 20th century. The age of death, of the end of faith.